This conference will now be recorded.
So hello everyone, I hope everyone is fine, and thank you for the people who have joined from that GoTo training link to GoTo meeting at such a short span of time. And just a moment please. Yes, so let's start with the today's session of IFRS. Our today's session of IFRS is about IFRS 9. So IFRS 9 is the most talked about standard since 2018. And the reason is because it brings in way more differences, way more contradictions, and it gives a total new picture to your financial statements, presentation, measurement, classification of your assets, liabilities, and so on, of your financial instruments. A widespread belief that IFRS 9 affects more than just financial institutions. It is not like that. Financial instrument, any organization that is dealing with financial instruments, comes under IFRS 9 framework. Any entity could have significant changes to its financial reporting as the result of this standard. So let's start with the overview. IFRS 9 includes requirements of recognition and measurement, impairment, derecognition, and general hedge accounting of your financial instruments. The objective of this standard is to establish principles for the financial reporting of financial assets and financial liabilities that will present relevant and useful information to the users of your financial statements for their assessment of the amounts, the timings, and the uncertainty of the entity's future cash flow. So IFRS 9 main, the basics will fall on the amount, timing, and the certainty or an uncertainty of the entity's future cash flow. Any cash flow that is arising from my financial instruments, be it an asset or a liability. The version, there were various versions that were coming out of IFRS 9 since 2011, 13, 14. There were various versions that came out, but the final version that is of 2014 supersedes all the previous version and is mandatorily effective from on and after 1st of January 2018. So this is one of the things that IFRS 9 effectiveness is on financial statements that are prepared on or after 1st January 2018. There was a recent study worldwide that was done on IFRS 9 implementations, implications, and so on. So in that study, all the most of the financial experts, they were good financial experts of big companies, they have actually located that IFRS 9 implementation and to show its implications on your financial statements, rather only implementation is going to take on an average 3 years. On an average, 3 years will be taken to implement IFRS 9 into the current happenings of my financial statement, in the current working patterns of my financial statements, the way I am working. So it is going to take an average of 3 years for implementation of an average entity. This was an average. So if any entity who its effectiveness is on from 1st of January 2018, so if an entity wants to apply it, the base implications of my implementation of IFRS 9 will be shown in 2021, that is 2021 or 2022, because of course we are suffering from this pandemic of COVID-19. So implications can be seen on 2022. This was a recent study that was done by most of the financial experts of various institutions. And the consequences that they actually had of IFRS 9 will be, they expected it to be more volatile income statement, because IFRS 9 is actually raising the risk that most asset will have to be measured at fair value, with changes in fair value recognized in profit and loss as they arise. So it is going to make my income statement more volatile. This is one of the major implications that IFRS 9 is going to have on your financial statements. Volatility of your income statement is one of those. Then another very major implication that it had was, now entities will have to start providing for future possible credit losses. Before, it wasn't the case. Any future credit losses, if I'm going to have, I'm also accounting for that also. And that too, starting from the very first period when I'm recognizing my asset, from that day also only I will have to provide for credit losses. So this is also an impairment condition that is put, a major impairment condition that is put by IFRS 99, and its implication is going to be shown on your financial position. So this is something, these are the two very major implications that will be seen by IFRS 9. And of course, IFRS 9 replaces IAS 39 that was looking on financial instruments before IFRS 9. Now, coming down to specially measurement. Usually, when we have any asset or liability, the the outline of going through it is, we classify it and we measure it, and then we look into the specific measurement clauses and everything that are provided by the standard. But here, there is something different. We'll see what is it different. Just look at this measurement clause first. Financial instrument, of course, for those who are not clear on what is the financial instrument definition that is provided by IFRS 9, a financial instrument is a contract which gives a financial asset of one entity and a financial liability or an equity instrument to another. So this was a very basic financial instrument information, but in case if anyone could have just not known or something like that. Any entity, first of all, will recognize or measure a financial asset or a liability in its statement of financial position when and only when the entity becomes a party to the contractual provisions of the instrument. Only when you become a party and not when you have a intuition or something like that, when you have any, only in talks of getting into a contract. When you enter into a contract, that is when you have to provide for measurement, recognition, classification, XYZ of IFRS 9 clauses in your financial statements. IFRS 9 requires to measure all the financial assets and liabilities at fair value at initial recognition, though adjusted with, in some cases, with the transaction costs. Transaction costs are basically the incremental cost directly attributable to the acquisition or disposable or a disposal of a financial asset or a liability. So fair value plus minus the transaction cost, that is the acquisition or disposal cost directly attributable to that financial asset or a liability. The fair value of a financial instrument at initial recognition normally is, but not always, the transaction price, because we are dealing with the financial instrument. So most of the time, the probability is that the fair value will be my transaction price, but it may not be the case all the time. Subsequent to initial recognition, after I have initially recognized that this is my financial asset or in liability, all the assets are within the scope of IFRS 9 and they are measured at amortized cost or FVTPL, that is fair value through profit and loss, or FVTOCI, that is fair value through other comprehensive income. There are three ways in which I'll be measuring subsequently after my classification. Once I've classified that this is a financial instrument, of course, classification will be based on when I become a party to the contract. Then I'll be judging it as a financial asset or a financial liability. There is one thing that, except for trade receivables, because trade receivables do not contain a significant financing component at initial recognition. Was there a disturbance in between? Hello? If anyone who is unmuted, please mute yourself. There was a quiet disturbance. Yes. So what are you saying? Yeah. At the initial recognition, except for trade receivables, I'm saying the reason is because they do not have a significant financing component at initial recognition. So an entity will measure a financial asset or a liability at its fair value plus minus, as I told you, it is the transaction cost, that is the directly attributable cost. Now, these are the three types how I'm going to measure it. Now, the reason I took measurement at first priority was because under IAS 39, what used to happen, assets were classified generally on the basis of their measurement. They were classified on the basis of their measurement. Under IFRS 9, the reverse is true. On the basis of which assets are measured is the way they are classified. So it is totally different. But of course, when we are transitioning from 39 to 9, we cannot just transition within a snap. It is going to take some time. That is the reason everything is going in a simultaneous way with 39, because of course, as I told you, we cannot just change within a snap. Classification of my asset, that is financial asset, is made at the time it is initially recognized, when the entity becomes a party to the contractual event or the contractual provision of the instrument, as I've already informed you. Classification of my financial asset, if I am classifying, is made on the basis of entity's business model for managing the financial asset. How is the entity planning to manage the business financial asset, as in what are the main intentions of the entity with that financial asset? They want to keep it, they want to sell it. How are they planning to go forward with the asset? And the second one is the contractual cash flow. Contractual cash flow characteristics of the financial asset, as in what are my contractual cash flows? What are the cash flows that I'll be generating from the contractual financial asset? What are the characteristics? Whether they are principal, whether it is an interest, whether it is repayment, what are the types of the cash flows that it is generating? Now, since the measure assets are measured in the way they are classified, so classification and measurement go hand in hand. If the classification changes, the measurement base is also going to change for the financial asset. We need to keep this in mind. This is very important. If my classification changes, my measurement way also changes. So under IFRS 9, it has laid down, it has established fundamentally different criterias, unlike on IAS 39, for determining the categories which are applied and what basis are they classified. So altogether, if I see, there are three bases for classifying the asset that are the basis. Let's look at the models on which my classification will depend. First is known, there are two tests, let's say, I'll get it more simpler for you. When I am classifying the way of measurement, that is amortized cost, FVTPL, or my FVOCI, when I'm going, I need to classify my asset, or I need to pass, my asset need to pass two tests. One is the business model test, and one is the SPPI criteria. Business model test says that financial asset is held within a business model whose objective is to hold financial asset in order to collect contractual cash flows. So I am just holding the financial asset. My only intention is to hold the financial asset and collect whatever the cash flow is that asset is generating. SPPI criteria says that the contractual term of the financial asset give rise to specified dates to cash flows that are solely payment of principal and interest on the principal amount or outstanding. So SPPI criteria is the basic for all those, because any contractual asset, if you are dealing with, it is going to generate cash flows on a specified date for principal interest repayment, which is obvious. Now business model test, there is one more, which is my financial asset, of course, it is held for to collect the contractual cash flow, but my intention is also to sell the financial asset. My intention is also to sell the financial asset. In the business model A, I only have the intention to collect the contractual cash flow. I am not planning to sell it in any near future. I do not have that in mind that I am going to sell it. But in business model B, I am planning to sell my financial asset after some time, or maybe within a specified period or something like that. So these are my three categories: amortized cost, FVOCI, and FVTPL. How am I going to classify it and measure it accordingly? When business model A and SPPI criteria is met, I am going to measure my financial asset as per my amortized cost. So what does that mean? When I am holding a financial asset with a view to collect the contractual cash flows, and it is generating a cash flow on a specified date that are solely the principal payments and the interest repayments. What is, where I am going to measure FVOCI? When SPPI criteria is met, but my intention on the financial asset is to sell it also. I also intend to sell the financial asset in any near future or at any point of time or a specific period of time. So this means if condition A, that is the business model, I'm only holding it to collect the contractual cash flow and to sell an asset, I am going to measure it as per FVOCI, that is fair value through other comprehensive income. And in case if any of the conditions are not met, if my conditions are not met, they do not fall under any of the category, then it is measured as FVTPL. So FVTPL, any asset is measured as FVTPL only if it is not measured by amortized cost or FVOCI. So FVTPL is a total different category, and amortized cost and FVOCI takes into account SPPI criteria with a smaller, with a simple change in the business model test. These are the two tests that are actually indicated by IFRS 9 for which my financial asset should pass to be measured it at amortized cost or the FVOCI. And if this is not the case, then it shall be classified as FVTPL and it is measured as it is measured at FVTPL. The practical implication or implication of these criteria is that subject to a special FVOCI, that is fair value through other in other comprehensive income designation option, for investment in equity instruments, only loans, receivables, and investment in debt instruments and other similar assets like loans and receivables can qualify to be measured at amortized cost or FVOCI. So in case if both of these tests, that is business model and SPPI, have to be met in order to account for an instrument at amortized cost or FVOCI, it is totally depending on the person who is going through the measurement classification criteria to judge it, whether you want to make it FVOCI or amortized cost. So there is no implication, there is no said rule of this is to be classified as amortized cost or FVOCI, since SPPI criteria is the same and there is a small change in the business model test. So it depends on the judgment of the person performing this measurement classification criteria to take amortized cost to be measured or an FVOCI to measure a financial asset as the person may think appropriate or the entity may think appropriate. And if nothing falls, if both the criteria, both the conditions are not met, FVTPL is the answer. Now let's look at the impact. What will be the impact on the financial statement if I am measuring an financial asset as amortized cost or an FVOCI or an FVTPL? Let's start with amortized cost. When I am measuring it as classifying and measuring the financial asset as amortized cost, asset is measured at an amount recognized in initial recognition minus the principal repayments plus or minus the cumulative amortization of any difference that has occurred between the initial amount and the maturity amount, and any loss allowance. Interest income is calculated using the effective interest rate method and is recognized in P&L. Any changes in the fair value are recognized in profit and loss when the asset is derecognized or reclassified. Under IFRS 9, if any asset is derecognized and reclassified and the effects of it are ongoing under P&L, then it can also be, it is also, they are also using the term as FVOCI no recycling, or FVOCI recycling, or FTPL recycling, or FTPL no recycling, amortized cost recycling, and no recycling. So basically, no recycling implies that when I am derecognizing or reclassifying my financial asset as per any other measurement or classification criteria, then the change will not be will not be seen in my P&L, will not be accounted for in my P&L. And if I am accounting for that change of reclassification of derecognition in my PL, that is P&L, then it is known as recycling. So these are the terms that are actually used. The asset is, when the asset is measured through FVOCI. So when I am measuring an asset from FVOCI, there are implications due as per whatever is explained in my IFRS 9. There has been conclusions on that loans and receivables and any investment that is done in the equity instrument are usually measured by FVOCI. because the reason is I am holding it with a view to resell it, to trade on it maybe for profit or something. So these are the conclusions that have been drawn from it. So when I'm talking about loans and receivables, interest revenue, impairment gains or any impairment losses, if there is a foreign exchange gain or losses, are recognized under the profit and loss on the same basis as it was done under amortized cost assets. Any changes in the fair value, changes in the fair value in FVOCI are recognized initially in other comprehensive income, not the P&L. It is recognized in the other comprehensive income. Do not account for the changes in the fair value at initial recognition for in P&L. It is recognized in other comprehensive income. And when an asset is reclassified or derecognized, the changes in the fair value that were recognized in OCI, because we have recognized for the changes in the fair value in the other comprehensive income, are reclassified into profit and loss. So whatever changes that I had accounted under OCI are at the time of reclassification are again classified in my P&L at the time of reclassification or derecognition. FVPL, as it is very simple, the asset is measured at fair value and changes in the fair value are accounted for or recognized in my profit and loss as and when they arise. So FVTPL is very straightforward and simple and in accordance with the conceptual basis as we are working. So FVTPL, any asset, if it is measured as FVTPL, then it is valued at fair value and whatever my changes are, they shall be accounted for when they are occurring, not about to occur, but when they are occurring in my profit and loss account. Simple. There are certain examples that have been over the world. There have been experts. They have just they have accounted for certain examples that might be used. The reason they have done a research on that, and this is because my implication and implementation of IFRS 9 starts from 1st of January 2018. And as I have already informed you that there was a study that said at least 3 years will be taken by an entity on an average to imply the IFRS 9 and to see its implications. So these are certain examples. Which after passing through business model test and SPPI criteria, they will be classified as AC or FVOCI. AC, or that is amortized cost or fair value in other comprehensive income, are taken almost in the same way because there is a small change in the financial asset selling only. There is nothing different in that. So an entity can appropriately, as it thinks appropriate, can measure it as per amortized cost or FVOCI. And FVTPL, of course, is totally different because none of the tests, that is business model or SPPI test, none of the test is passed by FVTPL assets. So the first one, let's start with, is trade receivables. Any trade receivables that is required payment only of fixed amounts on fixed dates. So such trade receivables will be measured as per FVOCI or amortized cost as the company may think fit. Then a full recourse loan or any investment that is done by the entity in the debt securities that will require fixed payments on fixed dates. Now, floating rate loans are actually full recourse floating rate loans that require fixed payments on fixed dates of principal, and the interest that is there, the interest rate is and based on the floating rate, that is the floating market rate interest. And any, of course, bank deposits that are repayable on demand, where interest, if payable, is at fixed or floating market rate. Interest can vary, but of course, it has to be paid. That is the catch here. Floating interest rate does not mean that it is not following the FCPI criteria. Floating interest rate means the interest rate is going to increase or decrease, but it has to be included. Now, coming down to the FTPL, any investment that is in the common shares where the holder does not designate the asset as FVOCI, that is, it is not intending to sell the shares in any near future, or it is not kept it for trading. Investments in mandatorily redeemable preference shares and instruments such as mutual fund units, when non-payment of dividend is not a breach of contract, and also the holder cannot claim fixed amount in bankruptcy. Then purchased option, swaps, forward contract, sells, these are the self-standing derivative financial state assets. They will also be measured at fair value through profit and loss. And a non-recourse loan, where the initial recognition, my lender whoever is the lender has the economic exposure to the underlying assets value and cash flows, but it is greater than the basic lender. The basic lender writes whatever is provided, it is more than that. That is the reason it is classified in FVTPL. At initial recognition, any entity at its sole option may irrevocably designate an investment in an equity instrument at FVOCI. We have seen that equity instruments shall be measured at FTPL, but it is totally on the options. These are certain options that are provided by the IFRS 9. So it is on the option of my entity to classify it as an equity instrument, as classify it and measure it as an equity instrument as FVOCI. But it is on the option of the entity and it is irrevocable. You cannot change it. It is irrevocable. But there is an exception to it. The equity instruments held for trading or are in contingent consideration to my business combination. As we have seen, if I have these equity instrument as a contingent consideration under IFRS 3 of business combination, or if they are held for trading, these are the exceptions out here. So if when I am, there is one more thing, when I am taking my equity instrument as an FVOCI, so the any dividend, that is the dividend received, are recognized in qualifying dividends are received in recognized in profit and loss, and changes in the fair value recognized in OCI, and can never be put back to PNL if the asset is reclassified. There is this one exception to it. It cannot be reclassified to profit and loss. Even if my financial asset has become impaired, it has got credit impaired. It has become credit impaired. I'm going to incur loss. I cannot reclassify it back to my PNL. It will be shown in my OCI only. That is the other comprehensive income only. Coming down to embedded derivatives, what did IAS 39 did was, it required an entity to measure the derivative financial assets, that is embedded also, in non-trading financial assets separately at FVPL. If the economic risks and characteristics of the derivative are not closely related to the host contract and the entire contract is within the scope of IAS 39. But IFRS 9, there is no special treatment that is given to such arrangement of embedded derivatives. The entire contract is to be classified either as an amortized cost, FVTPL, or an FVOCI, following the basic criteria that is given, that is the two-test model check. If an entity is measuring a derivative embedded in a financial asset at FVTPL under IAS 39, the entity usually can expect that it will have to measure the entire asset at FVTPL under IFRS 9. The reason is the contractual cash flow that will be generating will not represent solely payments of the principal and the interest on the principal outstanding. And that is the reason my SPPI test will not be met. And the result will be, there will be an increase in my income statement volatility. My income statement will become more volatile. IFRS 9 again extends the accounting mismatch designation option to contracts for the purpose or sale of non-financial items that may be settled net in cash or another financial instrument, and that were entered into for the purpose of the receipt or delivery of any non-financial item in accordance with the entity's expected purchase. So it is the contract here specifically specifies that entity was going to purchase something. There was an expected purchase, sale, or the usage requirement. So that was the reason the financial instrument was a party to that. This option must be made only at the inception of the contract and only if it eliminates or significantly reduces the recognition inconsistency. If my recognition inconsistency can be reduced, only then for that purpose I can do this. Impairment under IFRS 9 is very important because a totally new way of impairment or impairment losses is looked upon, is introduced rather, under IFRS 9. Before coming down to this impairment, I have an Excel example to show, and I would rather prefer showing it here only at this point of time. I hope the example is visible. Yes, it is. Yes. So this is actually how I'm going to account for any asset, any financial asset, as per my FVTPL and as an amortized cost. So there is an entity, KB Limited, and it purchased a 5-year bond on 1st of January 2015. The cost of it was $5 million. And the annual interest is at that time was 5%, which is also the effective rate that will be payable on 31st of December annually. Now, at the reporting date of 31st of December 2015, interest has been received, and the expected market rate interest is 6%. Now, on the date when it was issued, it was 5%. But now when it came down to payment time, the interest rate changed, increased from 5% to 6%. So I will be using the same example for classifying it as an FTPL or an amortized cost. FVOCI not, because amortized cost and FVOCI are almost similar. They have the almost similar calculation accounting pattern. It is just you need to show the changes of the fair value or any losses or profits on the other comprehensive income. this is the only change. That is the reason amortized cost and FVOCI have almost the similar accounting pattern. So $5 million is the bond amount. Interest is 5% on the date of issuing. On the date of payment, it came increased to 6%. Now, when I'm classifying it as amortized cost, at FVTPL, let's start with FVTPL. Is it available? Is it something like that? So sorry, there was a typing mistake that I did. Yes, under FVTPL, as we have seen, that FVTPL recognizes the asset at the fair value and recognizes the changes or anything or the interest under the P&L as and when it is occurring. So FVTPL will require the fair value of the bond measured upon the expected future cash flows discounted at the current market rate. This is the difference between amortized cost and FVTPL. FVTPL accounts for the things on the present happening. Whatever is the present happening, I'm going to account it for that in that way. So my present, rather the current market rate when I'm accounting for it on 31st of December 2015 is 6% and not 5%. 5% was at the day when I purchased the bond and what was promised. But on accounting, that is on 31st of December, when I'm going to account for my interest, it is 6%. So I'll be taking that as current rate only, that is 6% only. So I have got the present value of my future cash flows here, and I've discounted it at 6% rate, that is the current market rate and not what was at the time of entering the contract, that is at the time of my purchasing the bond. So I am going to discount it at 6%. These are the present values for the first year, second, third, and fourth year because it was a 5-year bond. So in the first year, second, third, and fourth, these are my present values. They have been arrived by the basic Excel formula of present value. So my fair value of that bond on 31st of December 2015 came down to be 4.82. Since it was $5 million, it is $4.82 million on 31st of December 2015. So I have accounted for it, I have discounted it at 6%, and this is the value of my bond on 31st of December 2015 and not 5. So whatever is the difference, that is 5 minus this fair value of 31st of December, this is the fall in the value, that is any impairment, and that will be accounted for in the P&L because in FTPL there is no other comprehensive income, there is no other kind of accounting. Any change that is happening, any value loss that is happening, that is the fall in the value that is happening, is accounted for in the P&L account only. And the interest received at the end of each year, that is 5%, because the interest will be received, of course, on 5% only. So will be recorded at in the P&L account as and when I have received it. If I receive the interest on 31st of December only, without any increase on 31st of December only, let's say I am receiving the interest on 31st of December only, every year until in the next 5 years, I am going to account for that 0.25 in my P&L account. This is how I'm going to account for an FVTPL. So FVTPL looks at the fair value based on the current market condition and account for that. and any accounting that takes place for the purpose of, may, let's say, fall in the value of my asset or any interest receiving is accounted for in P&L, and nowhere else needs to be seen an effect on it. Now, when I come to amortized cost, AC is actually amortized cost. AC requires, that is amortized cost requires, that the fair value of the bond to be measured upon the expected future cash flow, and they shall be discounted at the original effective rate, that is 5% only. So I am going to discount my future cash flows at 5% only, because that is the case of my contract. So amortized cost takes into whatever was the terms at the time of getting into a contract. You can just say for our classification, there is no IFRS 9 classification or any specification that is required. It is just for the easing out the purpose of your calculation. At the time of when you have entered the contract, whatever are the norms, whatever is the interest, whatever is the effective rate, you're going to discount your cash flows, get the present value at the effective rate only, at what rate you will be getting the interest and not what is the market rate. So when I am discounting my future cash flows at 5%, so the present values of my future cash flows are this. Again, the same present value formula has been used. And since I am not using any change in the interest rate, effective interest rate, so my fair value on 2015, the first day of receiving my interest, remains the same. There is no change in the fair value because the rate that I've used is the same on what it was promised to me. There is no fall in the value because there is no interest rate differentiation that has happened. And again, any interest received under amortized cost also, when it is received, it is accounted for in the P&L. So when I am going through my FVTPL, my P&L is showing effect of these two on the fall of the fair value on 31st of December. It is showing me a fall in the fair value and the interest received. But when I'm going through an amortized cost method, only interest received is accounted for at the end of every year of my bond period, for the bond period. So FVTPL and amortized cost, or FVOCI, because FVOCI, as I told you, has the same accounting pattern. It is accounted for just in the same way. Sorry. And any changes in the fair value, if happens, they go in the OCI and not the P&L account. If, let's say, there is any change here, there was any change, they declared themselves that we'll be providing you with an interest of 6% since the market rate has changed or something like that, and had there been any fall in the fair value under amortized cost or FVOCI, fall in the fair value changes shall be accounted at in the OCI account and not in the P&L account. This is the only difference. So yes, it was just for for the FVOCI example. Any FVOCI change in the fair value, change at the value at the recognition rate, recognition date, it shall be accounted for in the OCI and not the P&L account. This is the basic difference between amortized cost and P&L, that is FVTPL. Otherwise, there are no such differences. It is just present value of the future cash flows accounting and your recognition and different account, P&L account or the OCI. So this was the example that related to the calculations of FVTPL and AC, that is amortized cost or FVOCI. And there is only one difference. If there is any express change in the terms and there is a fall or increase in the value, fair value of my asset or the bond in terms here, then it will be accounted for in the OCI. Otherwise, in FVTPL, P&L account will be affected two times, one with the interest received and one with the fall in the value. But here only interest will be received will be shown in AC, that is amortized cost method of measuring a bond or any financial asset or instrument. So this is the Excel example, which included only one calculation for present value formula. Rest, anyone if has an question about this example can of course shoot it. I mean, just ask it on the chat box. You can of course type it if you want to. If you have a question or something, you can use this time to you ask the question, because once we if we are going forward, once we get to the next questions and everything, it you might get confused or something. So if anyone wants to ask a question on the calculations on accounting methods or something like that. Okay, while I move forward to the slide, anyone who's got a question can put it under the chat box. Yes. Now it's visible. Yes. Now coming down to the impairment aspect of my financial instruments. Of course, impairment aspect of the financial instrument, as I already informed you, that the impairment aspect of the financial instruments are one that are modified on a new or rather introduced in a totally new way under IFRS 9. IFRS 9 actually establishes a total new model for recognition and measurement of impairments in loans and receivables that are measured at amortized cost or FVOCI. The so-called expected credit losses model. A new model that has been introduced is known as expected credit losses model. Only amortized cost and FVOCI only. Reason being, because when we account for an asset and measure it as per FVTPL, any impairment losses or something that are done at the time of the happening of an event. Like we had the current market rate in the last example that we took was 6%. We have accounted it, and it was that accounting, I mean that effect was immediately shown in the P&L. So there is no impairment that needs to be done in case of FVTPL. Immediate effects are shown under my P&L at the time of happening of that event of increase in rate or decrease in rate or anything that has happened in terms of my financial asset or financial instrument. So any asset, financial asset amortized, measured at amortized cost or FVOCI. So the new model that affects them under the impairment thing is the expected credit loss model. This is the only impairment model that is applicable in IFRS 9, because all other assets are classified and measured at FVTPL, or in the case of qualifying equity instruments, FVOCI with no recycling to profit and loss. So FVTPL and FVOCI with no recycling. I've informed you about FVOCI recycling and no recycling. So if my FVOCI no recycling is happening, no effect is shown in my P&L, and same is the case at the time of classification and measurement or reclassification recognition. And FVTPL also is the same case. There is no effect on the profit and loss that is showing. So it is almost equivalent. IFRS 9 impairment model applies to assets that are, as we have seen, FVOCI, the recycling and amortized cost, and any loan commitments, guarantee contracts, contract assets, lease receivables, anything that are not measured at FVTPL. instead of when we are talking about credit losses, we'll be talking about expected credit losses under the impairment model. So credit loss is basically the difference between the contractual cash flows that are due to an entity when at the time of entering the contract or as per the contract, and all the cash flows that the entity expects to receive discounted at the original effective interest rate. So any difference between what I am ought to receive and what am I expected to receive, any difference between that is known as credit loss. The expected receivable might be 1 lakh. Receivable was 1 lakh. But now I am seeing that there might be defaults, there might be failures, and at the end of my period of the contract, the only thing that I'll be receiving is only 20,000. So 80,000 is basically my credit loss. Now coming to expected credit loss, the expected credit loss model that is actually presented in IFRS 9. Expected credit losses are calculated. There are 4 steps through which I will be calculating my expected credit loss. One is identifying the scenarios in which a loan or receivable will default. What are the scenarios that may occur due to which I'll see a default in my receivable or the loan? Then second comes is estimating the shortfall that would be incurred in each scenario if a default were to happen. If any default happens, what is the amount that I'll not receive? Cash shortfall is the amount that I'm not going to receive in every scenario, because there might be 10 scenarios. If this happens, then also it can happen a default. If this thing happens, then it can result in a default. I can create 10 scenarios in that. So cash shortfall for every particular scenario. Then third step is to multiply the loss by the probability of the default happening. Like, let's say if I had provided a loan in 2019, the probability of happening of COVID-19 was zero. No one would have expected that a COVID-19 would affect so much the whole world, and there it might create havoc and create chaos in the business world too. So the probability of COVID-19 was almost zero. Probability of a person, let's say, if I provided an entity, a loan or any receivable or something, and that entity going bankrupt, the probability that I am expecting based on its past performances, past trends, current trends, etc., I am expecting that the probability of the company or the entity going bankrupt is 2% probability it is there. So my probability for that happening will be 2%. This is how I am going to take out the probability and multiply it with the shortfall. Then fourth step is to aggregate, that is to sum up the results of all such possible events that are going to happen, because the aggregate of all such results is going to affect in my financial statement. This is a small example that I have taken. At the time of entering the contract or as per my contract agreements and everything, my estimated future cash flow was $50,000. Now, if any default happened, any mishappening happened, or there is a failure in payment that happened, my estimated cash flow is that I'm going to get back at least $10,000. This is the minimum. This is the amount that I'm going to get in any happening or any default that is going to happen. So my shortfall, that is cash shortfall, is $40,000. Now, $40,000 are something that I'm not going to receive, that amount I'm not going to receive in any case. And the probability that a default might happen, let's say the probability of the company going bankrupt is the company to whom the loan was provided or I was in a contract with, probability of it going bankrupt is 3%. So my expected credit loss will be 1200. I've identified one scenario, that the scenario is company or the entity going bankrupt. Cash shortfall I've ascertained is $40,000. The probability of the default happening is 3% based on the trends, market trends and everything. And I, after multiplying it with the shortfall, my expected credit loss comes down to be 1200. This is not how it is actually happening, but this is just for the information of what is shortfall, what is probability default, and what is the effect, and how do we calculate the expected credit loss happen. This is just an example for that. Now, it is known as an expected credit loss. The term is actually derived because from the statistical study that happens. Under the study of statistics, there is the term expected is actually used when of weighted average of outcomes weighted by the probability of their occurrences is used to define a probability or used to describe a probability. So this expected credit loss is taken from there because the it is dependent on happening of an event, the probability of that event happening, and weighted averages of course, this is only one scenario. I can have 10 scenarios. So I'm going to assign weights to which scenario is going to happen probably, and the probability of that scenario. So that is the reason it is taken expected credit loss. Now, ECL is actually expected credit loss. There are certain expected losses are recognized and measured according to the approaches that are laid down by the IFRS 9. There are basically three approaches. There is a general approach to classify the ECL and measure the ECL, a simplified approach, and the credit-adjusted approach. So this is also a term that IFRS 9 has coined, that is credit-adjusted approach. Under general approach of IFRS 9, impairment follows a three-stage model. It is known as a three-bucket model. And any changes in the loss allowance, my loss allowance change is recognized in the P&L as impairment gains or losses. It is usually applicable on loans or receivables that are not covered under any other approach. So you can take this general approach to be an FTPL, which anything that doesn't falls in the other two category automatically falls under the general approach. That is the reason it is named as general approach. Coming down to the simplified approach. Simplified approach is coined to assess the entities that have less sophisticated credit risk management systems. So IFRS 9, what does it do is, under IFRS 9 simplified approach, entities do not have to track the changes in the credit risk of financial assets. Instead, lifetime ECL are recognized, that is expected credit losses are recognized from the date of initial recognition only of the financial asset. Simplified approach is required basically for the trade receivables, contract assets that result from transactions that are within the scope of IFRS 15 and do not contain a significant financing component. For trade receivables and contract assets that do not contain a significant financing component, entities choice is it is on the entity to choose whether to apply a simplified approach or a general approach. So under simplified approach, usually this is the approach that might be since application is only intended from 2018, 1st of January. Most of the entities that do not have a systematic credit risk management, let's say the MSMEs that will be said, they will be following the simplified approach, because under simplified approach, you do not have to work under stages or work under classification basis of credit loss probability and scenarios or something. You just classify it to be a lifetime expected credit loss. There are no stages on initial stage, expected credit or something. There are various stages under the three bucket model that is provided by the general approach. But in simplified approach, you provide a lifetime ECL, that is the expected credit loss. So you do not have to worry much about the risk management, the probability of a risk or something that is going to happen. Now, under the credit impaired financial asset, this is a specific approach that has been set in by the IFRS 9. For the assets, for these kind of assets, entity recognizes only the cumulative changes in the lifetime ECL since the initial recognition of such an asset. Purchased any credit impaired credit impaired assets are actually assets that have been purchased or originated credit impaired financial asset. That is, it is credit impaired on the initial recognition only. Credit impaired means I do not see it getting repayment at any near future. Let's say they have become a bad debt. You can equivalent to a bad debt. I do not see any coming back from that asset. There is no coming back. I do not expect it to provide me with any cash flows. I do not expect any future cash flow from that asset. So they fall under the credit impaired financial asset. The only accounting that is done under credit impaired financial asset is the changes in the ECL. If my rate of interest changes, if anything changes, just those changes are accounted for. On the initial recognition only, I have declared it credit impaired, and I will be only accounted under impairment of that asset as cumulative changes in the lifetime of the ECL. Any changes that occur in the ECL calculation. Yes, so under the three bucket model that we were discussing under the general approach, three bucket model is actually divided into three stages, where only in the initial recognition only a 12 month ECL calculation is done. Only on the initial recognition a 12 month calculation is done. The rest two stages, a lifetime ECL is classified and accounted for. That a lifetime expected credit loss is accounted for. Increase in the stage two is basically increase in the credit risk. When I have assessed in the initial recognition, the risk related to that asset is actually 5%. But after 12 months or after a certain period of time, it has increased to 7%, 8% or 9%. The probability of the failure has increased from 3 to 5 to 7, or any increase is happening in the probability of that happening of an event. Then I'm going to, the risk is of course increasing, and I'm going to account it for the lifetime ECL approach. Let's just follow it with an example. How do we account for an ECL and a lifetime ECL? But before that, what is a lifetime ECL and what are 12 months ECL? We need to see it. Lifetime ECL are basically the expected credit losses that result from all possible defaults or all possible default events that are going to happen over the expected life of financial instrument. And lifetime ECL are therefore the present value of the difference between the contractual cash flows that are due to an entity under the contract and the cash flow that the entity expects to receive. These are the basic lifetime ECL. So in general words, whatever is I'm expecting to receive at the end of the contract or in the whole lifetime is my the difference between them is the lifetime ECL amount that shall be accounted for. And for the 12 month ECL is basically a portion of the lifetime ECL only, and it represents the lifetime ECL resulting from the default that may occur in the 12 month period after I have had an expected probability of an happening of an event and something has happened in the next 12 months. Whatever event that occurs, I'm going to account for that only in my 12 month ECL. Other than that, as we have seen in the three bucket model, there is an accounting to be done only for the lifetime ECL. We'll be coming to the cash flows, but let's see to the Excel example. Yes. Yes. On 31st of December 2014, there was an entity vague that lends to entity fraud $1 lakh. Now, entity fraud will, the contract says that the entity fraud will repay the loan in 5 annual installments amounting to 25,000 per installment. So, all in all, I'm going to get at the end of this contract end period after 5 annual installments, I'm going to get $1,25,000. Now, the calculation of the ECL shall be based on the PD, LGD and EAD model. This is the basic ECL calculation models where. Where PD is the probability of the default. Here they have clearly given that the probability of default is 3%, but it has gradually increased to 4% in the last 2 years. EAD is actually exposure to default. That is the any amortized cost of a loan is the exposure at default. That is what is the amount that I'm going to get. And the loss given default is the percentage that I will not be recovering. That will not be recovered if the default happens. So it is just the ECL is classified and calculated on the PD, LGD model only. A PD, LGD and EAD model, where PD is the probability of default, EAD is the amortized cost of the loan, and LGD is the loss given default. So anyone who has an problem or who has an issue with the PD, EAD and LGD specific criteria, what is PD, what is EAD and what is LGD, because as we move forward to the question, to the calculation, it is going to affect the understanding of course of yours. So anyone who has confusion with the PD, EAD and LGD, okay, so since everyone has got the PD, EAD and the LGD things, of course, since as we see here, there is no expected rate that is given. Hello. Am I audible? Hello. If in case I'm not audible, please do let me know, because I'm continuing. I suppose I wasn't audible in between. Yes. As you've seen that there are no interest rates that are given out here. There is only the principal payment and whatever will be the repayment consists of. So after this, we are going to calculate an expected interest rate. expected interest rate, of course, is important because when I'm amortizing any asset or any loan, it has to be done at an interest rate. I will be calculating an expected interest rate based on my cash flows and the principal. So this is with the help of an rate return formula of Excel, I have calculated the expected interest rate. Now coming down to the amortization cost. Amortization cost is the amount that will at the end of my bond period or at the end of my contract period, what will be the amount that I'll be receiving in the form of interest, what will be the repayment done and everything. So that is, I am calculating amortized cost. So in the year 2015, my opening balance on 1st January is $1 lakh. Interest that is calculated, that I am the interest that I'm going to receive and I'm going to account for in P&L is $7,924. This has been calculated with our basic formula of the interest payment. The interest payment formula that we have, as you can see it here, the basic interest calculation formula, we have used that formula for the calculation of interest. And cash flow that I'm going to receive is, of course, 25,000 at the end of my year, that is at the end of my period of 2015. So now closing balance left is 82,924. Again, I'm going to do the same for the next 5 years for the period of my installments that I'm going to receive. This is all done with an expected view that this is what we are going to, this is what is actually going to happen. Similarly, we have just calculated the interest to be accounted for in the P&L, cash flows, and the closing balances, and at the end of on 31st of December 2019, my balance will show zero and all the payments will be done. Cash flows are done with, there is no payment left, and for 1 lakh loan given, I have received $1,25,000. This is the basic scenario that should happen. Now we have seen that the probability of default is 3% for the first 3 years, and it has gradually increased to 4% in the last 2 years. LGD is the percentage default, that is 80% percentage default that we have seen here. Loss given default, the percent of EOD that will not be recovered if the default is going to happen. So 80%, I have expected that 80% of the amount is not going to be received at the end. If any default happens, 80% of my amount is going to sink. Now on 31st of December 2015, 1 lakh is the amount. Probability of default assigned to it is 3%. This is the cumulative probability of default. 80% I am not going to receive if default happens, and my expected rate of return is 7.9%. So the ECL that I am going to account for is $2,223. 1 lakh by 1 lakh is the amount. Probability of default 3% has been multiplied, and the percentage that I'm not going to receive is multiplied. It is divided by, it has been discounted at the present value. So this is the amount that has been received. This is the basic amount that has been received. In the second year, I am going to account for this amount. Third, fourth, and at the end of my fifth year, my ECL total is $506. So the total of this is $6,722 is my total lifetime ECL amount. And for the first 12 months, my ECL that is going to account for is $2,223. So my 12-month ECL is $2,223 and my lifetime ECL is $6,722. This is the amount that we'll be accounting for in my books of accounts for the credit loss, expected credit losses. Yes. Now the cash flows are basically measurement cash for the cash flow is basically there. The reason is that the cash flows should, when I am expecting my future cash flow, the terms of the contract, the collateral that I have received, any credit enhancement scheme that is provided, they also need to be kept in mind when I am accounting for my future cash flows. Like the probability of default when increased from 3% to 4%, all these terms of contract should have been seen, and that is the reason my probability of default increased to 3 to 4%. Let's say the amount of the collateral was not enough to pay me back the amount, so I have increased the probability of default. There was a problem in the contract or something that has happened. That is the issue that might have happened, and due to that, the probability of default increase. So cash flows, when I am expecting the future cash flows, I am going to keep all these terms in my mind for the collateral, credit enhancement, contractual terms, expected life of my financial instrument, and all of these. And these are the basically liabilities that are dealt with IFRS 9. Liabilities are also accounted for in the same way as the asset. It is just that they are amortized, they are measured at the amortized cost only. There is no FTPL differencing or something. Only amortization is done for the financial liabilities. Financial liabilities is basically done for those people. One is the financial asset. The receiving person is the financial asset. The person, the other party creates a financial liability, and liability is amortized in the period of, as and when the payment is done. So this was it. And this is just for your information, financial instruments will be accounted for as and when they are measured. What amount will be accounted in which accounts? So these were the only things that were done. Hedge accounting is, of course, an important part of IFRS 9, but that shall be taken in a different hedge accounting session, of course. So if any doubts or anything, shall be emailed at support@bispsolutions.com. And all the slides and the Excel sheet shall be floated via mails. So thank you so much. Today's session. Tomorrow at Monday. Thank you.
Thank you, Sanjana.
Break. Hello. There was a voice. Hello.
Yeah, hello. Thank you, Sanjana.
You're welcome.